Hi, I'm Tony Velasquez, and welcome to Future Perfect Tech Shorts. Now, a scam robbing millions of pesos from ATM users was uncovered recently by the banking industry. Customers of local banks had their personal identification numbers, or PINs, stolen by an international syndicate specializing in duplicating ATM cards. Now, bank officials say the massive card skimming operation was first observed in 2011. It peaked toward the end of last year. Now, three main ATM networks joined forces late last year to implement measures to combat the scam. And tonight, we're joined by Drex Lagi, a computer forensics expert, Mike Kimson, the head of information technology and operations of Megalink, and Rene Natividad, the vice president and head of operations and network services of BankNet. So, Megalink and BankNet both represented here on Future Perfect. Drex, of course, you're helping out with the companies to improve their security systems. First of all, how serious is the skimming operation as it's been reported? Are we actually getting the complete picture now, or are we just, pardon the pun, skimming the surface?
Well, skimming is actually in the country for quite some time right now. And although, as some our experts have noted, that the surge happened sometime like last year, most of this syndicate, the members of the syndicate, usually came from other countries, and they saw that the Philippines is quite vulnerable right now, without further adding security features.
Okay, this is an international syndicate. I mean, it's not just one group based in one country that's doing it, but it's based in many different countries.
Well, from our sources, they came from mostly Eastern European countries.
Eastern European.
Yes.
Okay. So, parang mafia.
They
said mayroong Russian mafia, something like an Eastern European mafia. So, Rene, you're saying that the vulnerability in the Philippines is actually being exploited. How vulnerable are we? What are the vulnerabilities that have been exposed?
Well, they are exploiting how the ATMs are operating right now.
Okay.
They are installing gadgets to harvest information.
So physically installing it on the ATMs.
Yes, exactly. These are what we call skimming devices.
Okay.
The skimming devices are able to capture the information behind the card. If you will notice, if you look at behind your card,
none of you gentlemen, by the way, would have had a skimming device with you right now, would you?
No. We're the good guys.
Yes.
Really?
Yeah.
Yes. But don't the good guys need the equipment of the bad guys to know how you can combat them?
Yes.
Yes. Yes. We have that. We've already studied it, and
so you don't have it with you.
You don't.
You're not necessarily carrying a spare skimming machine with you, right?
No.
Okay.
It's
how big is it?
It's just a small device.
Right. It's basically, if you look at the fascia of the ATM.
Okay.
The card slot itself.
The card slot. All right.
I don't know if we have a picture. If you have you look at the card slot, it's similar to that. You place it on top of the card slot.
So it looks like it's part of the machine.
From the point of view of
an
untrained client
wouldn't know if he's inserting it into a skimmer.
Into a skimming device. That's a false device on top of the real card reader.
So you mean to say the Eastern European mafia hasn't yet designed a skimmer that would still look innocently like it's part of the machine? I mean, this one is easier to spot, that it's not part of the machine.
No, it isn't.
Really? It's inconspicuous.
Yeah. Yes. They even copy the color.
I see. So this is what it looks like on the inside. You're showing a picture of what it typically looks. So this is like the interior or the inside of the fascia that they put on the machine. So
this is the actual skimming device.
Is this a picture that you guys, is this a device that you guys retrieved from one of your machines?
Yeah, well, I think that's one of the skimming devices that was retrieved by one of the banks operating here in the Philippines.
Okay.
So if you will get that picture, you will notice that there's a small hole.
Yeah, that's where you insert the card. What do you mean small hole? Like a pinhole?
Yeah, the pinhole. Because essentially, the attacker would need two things. The information behind the card, the mug stripe, and your pin.
What's
your
the small hole? We can see the small hole. It looks like a mole, right?
Yes.
What
is
that?
That's where they put the mini or micro camera.
Oh, my God.
Yes.
The camera actually in that small hole.
Yes. So it actually, it's supposed to capture the pin. The
pin personal stroke.
Yeah, the pin, the personal identification number.
I see. Because the real fascia of the card slot in any ATM doesn't have that hole.
Yeah,
yes.
Exactly. Doesn't have
so
that hole.
It's a telltale sign that this is something irregular in the fascia.
Yeah, but for an ordinary person, you don't be able to
see the
detect
it.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, so
how many banks, Rene and Mike, have been targeted by this mafia locally?
Based on the reports that we got, there are at least 12 ATMs that were compromised.
Of different banks, no?
Yes.
And from both networks, Megalink and
networks,
BankNet.
12.
Okay.
12 to, I think the latest count would be 15, right?
Yeah.
So the machines lang, no?
Machines lang.
And this is all Metro Manila or also outside of Metro Manila?
Manila and outside Manila.
Typically in the provinces.
Outside the province.
Typically outside the province.
Areas where it's less guarded
and
less foot
highly
traffic.
Populated area, especially areas where there are lots of tourists.
Tourists?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Have you guys actually seen the ATM machines here in ABS-CBN? Maybe we should go and take a look after the show, right?
Yeah, let's check.
The pinhole camera is usually located on top, the topmost portion of the ATM. So that's in the position wherein if you look from that angle, you will see the actual pin stroke.
Uh-huh. The keystrokes.
The keystrokes, right.
Yes.
So aside from the data being captured in the card slot, plus the pin, the fraudsters would have a complete, they would have completed everything.
Now here's a question. I don't know, if people actually feel that it's necessary. Because you've installed these, what do you call them?
Skimming devices. Skimmers?
No, the key guards?
The pin shields.
You call them the pin shields? All right, the pin shields so that nobody actually sees which keys you're pressing.
It only works for guys with small hands.
I know what you mean. I actually have to peer under it to see what I'm pressing. So apart from that, are there any other security features that can be installed? Even on the card itself, that would make it more difficult to actually hack.
Well, the cheapest one would just be to cover your finger.
Your
fingers.
The pin shield.
Yes, the more elaborate ones and are more foolproof are the ones with security chips inside of them.
All right. So the chip technology that you're mentioning, the security chip, what does it do?
Well, he's the guy.
No, basically, if you look at the ordinary ATM card, it's just a mug stripe. If you put it in a card reader, there are already available devices in the market that can read information from this. But the critical...
You mean to say, Rene, you can buy it off the shelf?
You can buy
and read any card with it?
Yep.
Yes.
Wow.
Actually, one of the things you can do is you can get a MP3 player with the wireless transmitter and read the electromagnetic signals from
An MP3 player with a wireless transmitter?
Yes, so you could record the bits through sound and then you retrieve the MP3 sound and then play it back so you can re-record.
So it's actually the simplest way of skimming the information off the card.
That's one way, yes.
So which means that's the vulnerable feature of the card.
Of
now
the
if
card.
You say you install a chip in it, it makes it less vulnerable.
Because this will make it the validation of the card. No, the card info won't be copied instantly.
Uh-huh.
Right, because of the current reading devices are not yet in the market.
Oh.
Only a few are in the market.
The chip enables the ATM operator to encrypt the information on the card. Mm-hmm. Unlike the Magstripe, it's not encrypted.
It's not encrypted.
Actually, if you will notice when you enter the hotel where they record your hotel card,
yes,
it's the same devices that you can read
your ATM card with.
Yes,
because these are just RF readers, right?
Mm-hmm. Magnetic stripe readers.
Magnetic stripe readers, not necessarily RF.
Yeah, not necessarily.
Singing ba RF, eh? Because tinatapat mo lang doon sa
clock.
Oh,
that's different. That's different.
That's contactless.
Touchless. Which is bad for Valentine's, iba yung touchless contact. It's something we don't want to talk about during that. All right, but
critical here is the two-factor authentication. You have the first is the card info, which is in the card.
Sure.
The second is on your PIN.
Your PIN.
You have to get both of them to have access to the account.
To the account, yes.
So the fraudsters, if they copy the card info from your card, but if they don't get the PIN, nothing.
Yeah, no. That's why the PIN shields more effective.
It's the simplest protection.
There is a new technology in the market right now, which also handles... provides further security to the machine, it detects electromagnetic pulses.
Meaning to say, it's a foreign device trying to read.
Beeping into the machine. Then it sets an alarm. Mm. It shuts down the machine or whatever you want it to do. Mm. Or if you put in some countries they drill holes.
They actually do that.
Yeah. Uh-huh. To put cameras.
Now, when you talk about replacing the cards with the with chip technology, is that something that the banks, Megalink and BankNet networks, can actually do for all the cardholders now in the country?
It has to be regulated. It has to be issued by our regulator, the BSP.
It has to be approved by the BSP.
The BSP.
Okay.
Yeah, I think they're working on it right now.
So is there a problem with that, Drex, do you think?
Well, it's one of the things that the Banco Central, how they work, is that they're very conservative. They don't just jump onto a new technology bandwagon, but they have to study it, and then afterwards they issue a draft of the circular, then they pass it around to the banks. So the process takes a bit of time. Mm. So meanwhile, you have this formal process of adopting new technology. Meanwhile, the bad guys and bad girls are developing new technology, trying to jump ahead of you.
Yeah.
So that's our situation right now.
No, but at this point, chip technology is hack-proof so far.
Currently,
is it?
Yes. Currently. It provides a huge jump ahead of the bad guys because of the encryption technologies and the way it's designed. It's practically future-proof.
Mm. In the case of Malaysia, 10 years ago, they were the targets of these fraudsters. Oh. Millions of dollars have been stolen from the banks. But when the Central Bank of Malaysia mandated the chip technology, well, these fraudsters moved to other countries.
Yeah, and they set up Aman Futures. Why did we even get there? So... machines or ATM, the ATMs have been around since what? The late 80s? It's like 30-year-old technology, right?
Mm. Yep.
And really not much has changed, except for the fact that you're saying that the cards themselves have to be redesigned. Mm-hmm. But with the machines themselves, can there be some other security features, aside from PIN shields, which are basically just a cover, that can be done to the machine? I mean, how old... how much more can you improve on the ATM?
New ATMs that is coming out right now has a feature wherein if you put something in on the throat of where you put the card.
The slot?
Slot. It disables the entire ATM. So it detects change in the, let's say, shadow
somebody
or
tampering
lighting.
With the hardware.
Yes. So there are new ATMs that's coming out right now.
And is BankNet and Megalink investing in those new machines?
Well, not actually the machine. These are third-party devices being installed on the machines.
I see.
Third-party devices, but which cost around $3,000 each per machine.
I see.
So that's quite expensive for the bank.
So is there no Philippine innovation that can actually, or are we not allowed? Because these are like licensed proprietary technology.
We can
modify?
Modify, no.
The machines?
I don't think so.
Because when you buy these machines, you're parang under contract, you should not modify them.
Yes.
Unless they have the specific technology to do them themselves.
Unless they certify your technology that you can install it in their ATM.
Hindi ba inside job kaya yung iba dyan? I mean, the reason why these European mafias know how to hack the machines, because baka may mga taong who are actually part of developing these machines who are now working for them?
Well, you have to know the ATM, the inner workings.
Exactly.
The process. Yeah. In order for you to develop something that you can implement or you can install in the device so that you can harvest information. So you have to know the ATM. So and these people know these devices inside and out.
Yeah, suspicious, diba? Right?
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, the only guys who would know how these machines work are the guys who may have designed it themselves.
Actually, some ATM machines are for sale at eBay in the United States. So guys can buy them and then take them apart. And
so you reverse engineer it, and then
The operating system is also.
So I can imagine Renee and Mike have ATM machines in their houses, right? Like, parang, honey, I need eggs. Okay, withdraw ka dyan. How serious a problem is it now if, for example, the BSP takes some time approving chip technology for the cards? Would it seem everybody would be vulnerable even to, you know, parang even your online transactions, paano ba yun? Is that the same, merong same level of vulnerability?
Different authentication when it comes to online.
Yeah.
Banks have their own ways of identifying a user when they use their online system, meaning over the internet, versus the ATM. So.
So which one is more secure? You go out on ATM or you do your banking online?
Both have their own vulnerabilities. Eh.
Mm-hmm. Different.
It's different.
Different.
Yeah, different.
Different ones.
Okay.
An equivalent of, for example, ATM skimming in the physical world would on the online world would be what we call phishing.
Phishing.
It's also another attack wherein money has been transferred out of victims' accounts.
Yeah.
And same thing also with ATM skimming. The attackers focus on the credentials of the account owner.
And how do they get those credentials from you? By tricking you?
Correct.
Yeah.
Sometimes via email.
Yeah. So they'll send you a fake email telling you to reconfirm your password or something. Yeah.
That's right.
And then they actually
fake promotions. You want something. And you're asked to divulge.
I actually got a Twitter message.
Twitter.
You want something?
Twitter message, which says, have you seen this picture of you? It's funny. So now you're curious, right?
Right.
Then you click it.
And then you click it. Then it says, you need to reconfirm your password. And then I said, oh my God. Classic phishing.
Well,
right?
Other people,
I'm not going to fall for it.
Well, we are less vulnerable because we're not as famous as you are.
Oh, no. Nobody's going to get anything from us. Now, very quickly, when a customer gets duped, all right, when he gets his ATM data stolen, does the bank have any role, or at least to compensate that client for whatever he or she may have lost?
Well, the bank usually conducts really in-depth investigation. And if they find the complaint to be viable, they pay off.
You pay off. And that's in like an insurance PDIC, right?
I think they get from the bank.
From the bank,
from
PDIC.
From the bank.
But technically, since it's the user's fault, they are liable for their own mistakes.
That is also part of the opening of accounts. When you open an account, it says there that the PIN is associated only with you.
Of course.
If you divulge this, it's your fault.
But you didn't divulge it deliberately. Somebody was watching you through a pinhole. Anyway, we've run out of time, gentlemen, but hopefully with this discussion and with what the BSP now will have to review with regards to the chip technology for the cards, we'll actually see the incidences of ATM card skimming on the decline, or maybe just transferring to another country.
To another country.
All right, Drex Lagi, Michael Kimson, and Renette Natividad, thank you, gentlemen, for coming over to Future Perfect.
Thanks for having us. Thank you.
Well, coming up next, we look at the latest hybrid to hit the market. You're watching Future Perfect Tech Shorts. Welcome back to Future Perfect Tech Shorts. Now, environmentalists have more to be happy about now that wind power plants are becoming cheaper to build than coal-fired plants. And a Korean car maker focuses on fuel efficiency while beefing up its latest SUV. Meanwhile, Microsoft has unveiled its long-awaited laptop-tablet hybrid to customers, leaving many wanting more.
The Surface Pro has finally arrived, at least in the United States. Last February 9th, Microsoft's much-awaited tablet-laptop hybrid boasting desktop-class Ivy Bridge guts finally hit store shelves. Unfortunately, few people managed to get their hands on one. Tech websites reported that lots of stores that were supposed to sell the Surface Pro got only a handful of units. Thousands of tech enthusiasts who wanted to buy the Windows 8 tablet had to go home empty-handed. Visitors to Microsoft's own online store were equally unlucky. In a statement, Microsoft said that customer response to the launch of Surface Pro was amazing and that it was working with its retail partners to replenish supplies as quickly as possible. Angry customers, however, ranted about the lack of inventory and wondered whether Microsoft was deliberately understocking stores to drum up an Apple-style buzz about its products selling out. Of course, Microsoft could resolve the sellout controversy by releasing sales numbers for the Surface Pro, or make the public forget the controversy altogether by releasing even more units and send some Surface Pro love to the Philippines. Kia Motors, meanwhile, is not holding back its latest offerings in the Philippines. The Korean car manufacturer recently launched its updated line of SUVs in the market. The Sorento boasts of a sleeker design and an engine that's been beefed up to put it ahead of the market.
Our design team in Korea deemed it as a must to incorporate changes that were being requested by our market. The biggest advantage of the Sorento, if I may say, and I'm proud to say, is that when it comes to the engine technology, I think Kia is right now a little bit ahead of our competitors.
The 2.2-liter engine delivers 197 horsepower, which is far above the 160 to 170 horsepower delivered by its competitors, which have engine displacements of 2.5 to 3 liters. What this means for the Sorento is greater fuel efficiency that translates to 10 to 12 kilometers per liter in mixed city and highway driving. The instrument panel has a meter that will tell you if you are making the most out of your fuel.
The meter will tell you whether you are doing 10 kilometers per liter or you're doing 5 kilometers per liter, and you will see you can adjust your driving habits but by just looking at the instrument panel.
Thanks to all these innovations, the Kia Sorento also gives lower emissions.
Our diesel engines right now are far more advanced. They're very clean, and especially in Europe, we meet the European air standards.
With its sleek design, powerful engine, and clean and green credentials, the Sorento is one SUV that's definitely worth checking out. Speaking of green, environmentalists have something to cheer about. New Scientist magazine reports that building new wind energy plants have now become cheaper than building coal-fired power plants. Citing figures from Bloomberg New Energy Finance, New Scientist says that in Australia, a new wind plant could generate electricity costing between $80 to $113 per megawatt hour. New coal plants, meanwhile, would cost $126 per megawatt hour. Thanks to better designs, including longer blades and taller turbines, new wind farms have boosted overall efficiency and are now cheaper to deploy in most countries, except in China, which is building at least one new coal plant per week. But with Beijing already choking in the world's worst air pollution, it may be just a matter of time before China starts embracing the new green technology.
Well, now that the campaign season is upon us, expect wind power to actually go up more than just one notch. Now, thank you for joining us. I'm Tony Velasquez. You can join me again next week when we again examine the present and look ahead to the future perfect of Philippine tech.